topic will be BERs, TOS BERs. So we are talking about BER ejectors today. I will tell you something about how to choose the right units. So what we're generally talking about and what BER ejectors consists of. So Susumu has left now. So we are taking care that we have minimum 1.5 meters distance. So now I can take the mask off. So hi again. So this is how it looks if you had the mask on for a long time. So let's start the meeting. Let's immediately go to the session. Share screen. So there we go. As I said, today's topic will be BER, TOS BER ejectors. We're just checking if the presentation is on, but it's obviously not.
Your screen, will you click this again? And
okay, still some technical problems, but now we should have it. So now we are where we should be. I hope you all see the presentation now. To repeat myself, we are talking about Tsurumi BERs, TOS BER ejectors. So we are generally talking about a system that is aerating and mixing the medium. So first of all, I would like to go into the principle. So what is the working principle of the BER or the TOS BER? I mean, again, we are not talking about rocket science. We are talking about a submersible machine that creates a rotation of an impeller that is creating an under pressure in the piping that is caused by a Venturi nozzle. And so we have a combined aerator and mixing unit that you can use for underwater purposes as a submersed unit. So as the TRN that we had a couple of weeks before, we are talking about a self-feeding system. And that is using the Venturi principle. You can see the Venturi principle here. You got the mechanical, you got the submersible pump. This is giving a streaming, and this streaming is pressed through the Venturi nozzle. And by this, the speed of the medium increases very much. And due to this, you will create an under pressure above that area where you can see the writing air. And this is where we are physically are. So this is the mixture part where the air is drawn in by the Venturi principle. It's mixed with the medium, and then you discharge the mixture of water and air to the front of the machine. So as you can already see here, the main difference to the principle that the TRN aerators are using is that we just have one aeration direction. We are not talking about the radial system anymore, we are talking about a system with a defined streaming that you can already see in this trumpet in front of the machine. This is definitely and exactly the direction that the mixture of water and air is leaving the machines and creating the aeration effect and also the streaming. So the working principle surely results in a picture, in a mixing picture, in a bubble picture that the machine will create in the tank. So you can see two pictures on the right side. The first one is the picture that you would see if you look up from the top. So you got the machine with the diffuser, and this is the area where you have the rising bubbles. So the rising bubbles are shown by the small circles here, and the blue arrows are the streaming that's created by the machine. So you can already see the two main factors that the BER or the TOS BER ejectors are creating, or what's the purpose of the machine. You aerate a certain area and you also mix a certain area. If you check it from the side in the second picture, you can also see why you have these defined areas, because the bubbles will physically rise after the depth aeration effect, and you have a defined area where the bubbles will rise. The water current is surely also something that you will have a subconvection effect. The streaming is leading back to the machine because the medium itself is sucked in the machine, in the pump again, and creating the next streaming. So what you need to know, we are talking about the mixed aeration and mixing unit. I can already tell you the main difference that we are facing when we compare the BER system with the TIN system. The TIN system is a tested system. So we have tested this unit according to the EN12255, which is defining the oxygen input into clear water in tanks under standard conditions. So you can have kilogram O2 standard oxygen input values for the TIR aerators, but we don't have those values for the BERs. Frankly speaking, this means that we cannot guarantee any oxygen input figures for those units. And the main effect that you should be targeting with those units is the mixing effect. The area of mixing can clearly be defined. You will have an undefined aeration effect with non-standardized oxygen input values. So this is something that we have to keep in our head. If we want to go for a biological aeration unit, then the BER would not be the right choice. Let's talk about the naming of the version. So as the title of this presentation already says, we are talking about a TOS and a TOS BER. So a freestanding or a guide rail version. So the first one that we're talking about is the TOS version. This is the guide rail version. You can see it on the right side here. Guide rail always means that that's a similar part with the pumps. If we're talking about the pumps, a TOS and the guide rail system, you're talking about the claw, you're talking about guide rails, and you're talking about an installation where the pump can be extracted from the installation unit by just lifting it up along the guide rails. So you can have a fixed installation on the ground, and you can lift the pumps out easily during the maintenance process, for example, do the maintenance and easily lift them in among or along the guide rails to the original position again. If we're talking about the freestanding version, then we are talking about a version that is coming without the guide rails. So this is a version that you install on the ground of the tank. And if you want to lift out, you will have to lift out the unit in the complete way, including the diffuser, including the ejector, including the tank and the pipings. So in the naming of the pumps, you will already find the most relevant information about the unit itself. So let's go for the first one, the redlined one. TOS, as I said, stands for the guide rail version. 22 is a figure that will give you the information about the kilowatt motor output. In that case, we're talking about the 22. This means 2.2 kilowatt in that case. BERs, that's through the ejector series. And 5 is the version of the machine. That is always important if you are going to talk about spare parts, spare parts supply, and the choice of the right spare parts for this machine. If we're talking about the freestanding version, we are surely missing the TOS information because it's freestanding. The other information is completely identical. The 3.7 in this case is also giving you information about the motor output in kilowatt. So in that case, it's 37, it's 3.7 kilowatt. BER is the same ejector series, and the version in that case is also 5. So what is the difference between the two units, or how do you convert a normal pump into the suitable ejector unit? So generally, we need to know that all of those BER systems are based on the normal B series pumps. So if you want to choose a TOS BER, a guide rail pump, then you need to choose the pump first of all. So you can see that it's ranging from the 50B2.75 with 750 watts until the 100B45.5 with 5.5 kilowatts. So we have 5 different units in the sizes between 0.75 and 5.5 kilowatt. The next thing that you need to consider is the suitable TOS ejector. Ejector is the part in the middle with the Venturi nozzle. TOS ejector means that you have the duct foot for the installation on the ground and you got the guide rails. So this is the second part that you will need. And the third part that you will need to construct this TOS BER system is the trumpet or the diffuser. So we have a list that all our distributors should have on site. You should have on your computer if you choose that. It is the BER, TOS BER Excel sheet. where you will get all the information about the needed parts that are required to construct a system. So if we're talking about the TOS 8BER, for example, you will need the 50B 2.75 pump with 750 watts. You will need that diffuser with this article number, and you will need that TOS ejector with that article number. So it's quite easy to choose. If we're talking about the construction of the freestanding BER, we have some minor differences. So the pump is always the same, so it will not change. So we are talking about 750 watts until 5.5 kilowatts, same size, the same type of pumps. The ejector surely changes because we're not talking about a TOS ejector anymore. So we don't have the guide rail fixing, we don't have the duct foots. We are talking about a system that is directly mounted to the pump and to the ejector with some minor feet to install it freestanding on the ground. So this is quite different to the TOS ejector set. The diffuser again is completely identical to the version that you have seen before. So the major difference between the TOS BER and the freestanding BER is explaining from the ejector. TOS ejector is not ejector. Ejector is freestanding. TOS ejector surely comes with the TOS. The next point that we should consider is if we're talking about the freestanding version, we don't have a pump that is hanging in the installation accessories. It needs to be freestanding, and thus you will need a separate stand where the pump is in need for a separate stand. So the smaller pumps, you can see it on the picture, have integrated feet, but you might know it from our B-series. The B-series pumps from 5.5 kilowatt on, they will need separate stand feet. So that's the same case for this freestanding pump with 5.5 kilowatt. For the 100B for 5.5, you will not only need the suitable ejector in freestanding version, you will not only need the diffuser for the ejector 55, you will also additionally need the stand set. Please keep that in mind. This is one of the most relevant differences between the units. If you order this set with diffuser, ejector plus pump without the stand feet, you will not be able to install the unit freestanding because there's just simply no feet on the pumps. If we're talking about these five units of BERs or TOS BERs, we also have to ask ourselves how we choose the right unit for the application of the customer. So the sizing is relevantly depending on a few factors like the steering convection. So the goal behind this installation or choice of the right unit is to find a unit that is large enough to cover the entire surface area of the tank and also to mix the complete tank, but does not overlap the water currents of multiple units if you have installed more than one unit in the tank. So the principle is quite identical to the TRN units if you install them. So the information that you need to collect from the customers are identical. So what you will need if you have to choose the right unit is the information about the shape of the tank. So we're talking about the round one, we're talking about the square one, the rectangular one, the dimensions, so diameter in A, side lengths in A or side lengths A and B for rectangular, and also the medium depth. The medium depth is important because you have a physical maximum self-feeding area. So the negative pressure, the under pressure effect needs to be strong enough to make it possible that the machine draws in the air self-feeding. If you exceed the maximum installation depth, then the unit will just simply not work. What is the next information that we will need? So first of all, let's take a look on the maximum areas that the units will be able to completely cover. So we are at the point that the unit, the bigger it gets, the more it can mix. That is a quite logical fact, I guess. And if you consider those maximum mixing areas in the list here below, you can see that with 750 watts, the maximum mixing length, so this is the length where you can avoid the sedimentation of the sludge on the tank, is a length of 2 meters, a width of 2 meters, and the maximum medium depth is 4 meters for the 50 hertz units. It would be 3.5 for the 60 hertz, but that's not relevant for us. And you can also see that with the increasing motor sizes of the machines, the maximum length, the maximum width and the maximum installation depth, which is simply increase. So the biggest area that we will be able to mix with one unit would be 7 meters in length, 7 meters in width, and 6 meters in maximum self-feeding depth. So those are the frame factors that we have to consider when we choose the right unit. Because if we install one of the 55 BERs, for example, in a tank that is 10 by 10 meters, then you would just simply risk to have sedimentation in 3 meters in length, so outside the maximum mixing area, and also in width. You will have 3 meters risk area where sedimentation would most probably take place. Just to take off the ball of the maximum self-feeding depths again, if you install the unit in the depths that is much deeper than the maximum self-feeding depths, then you will not have an aeration system anymore because it will not aerate. It will just run as a pump, but that's it. So we don't support that. You should not use the BERs with closed air or also below the maximum self-feeding installation depths, but because this would just simply harm the machine and be contraproductive for the aeration effect. If you want to find the suitable solution with multiple units for a bigger tank, you should consider those values and you should try to find a solution where multiple units will be able to completely mix the area of the tank and to avoid the sedimentation of a larger sized tank. So general rule is, if you cannot go with one unit, go with multiple smaller units and try to cover the complete area using those maximum mixing lengths and widths. So if you now found the right unit that will be able to completely mix and aerate your tank, and you will have the situation that sedimentation can be completely avoided, then we also have to face the situation that we will have multiple possibilities to equip the tank with, let's say, 5 units, 5.5 kilowatt, or 10 units, 2.2 kilowatt, 7 units, 3.7 kilowatts. So what will be the right choice, except of the financial factor that we surely have in between it? The air input is the only factor that we can use for that. So if you have a tender layout and you have the requirements of the customer, then a very important factor is also the air input that will be needed and that needs to be defined by the customer. So beside the steering convection and the proper positioning of the tank and the complete mixing effect, we should also try to take care that we insert enough air volume to fulfill the requirements of the customer. So choosing the right units based upon the Newton meters, the Newton cubic meters air input per hour is quite easy. You know these diagrams already from our pumps. So you will have increasing depths on one side of the axis and the air volume in norm cubic meters air per hour on the other side. So those are the curves that you have for the aeration systems. Let's say that the need from the customer would be, let's say we were talking about a single application, we just need one unit and 5.5 kilowatt to completely cover the tank. And the customer wants to have 100 norm cubic meters air in 5 meters depth. So that's an easy one. You just check the 100 cubic meters, 5 meters depth, and you will have the point on the curve of this unit with 5.5 kilowatt. This will be the optimal case. So, but what happens if the customer wants to have 90 cubic meters in 5 meters depth? So in that case, we are somewhere around here. So it's below the curve. So in that case, openly said, we have to oversize because we can just simply not fulfill the requirements with the next smaller units. We always have to go to the next bigger one. If we would be at 110 cubic meters for 5 meter steps, then we can just simply not offer a system with one unit. Then we most probably have to go for two smaller units. So this is something where you have to play around a little bit with the figures and with the installation and with the units. Just use some basic mathematics or just simply contact us and ask us for a layout. The only thing that I need to make clear again is if the requirement of the customer is not air input, means input in norm cubic meters per hour, If the requirement is based upon oxygen input, kilogram or two per hour, based on European standards EN12255, then we cannot recommend anything because we don't have those values for the BERs. If this is the requirement of the custom and we are targeting a typical biological activation process, for example, then you have to go for a TIR aerator. You should not go for the BERs in that case. If the requirements are mixing the tank, cleaning the tank, inserting a defined number of norm cubic meter ambient air per hour, then you can go for the BERs if this is the goal. If the goal is a proper tender layout of activation with frame factors in kilogram or two per hour, please do not go for the BERs. We don't have any figures for that. So this is something that I cannot make clear enough. This is just a mixer and a rater without further defined oxygen dissolvement. It is a mixer and a rater that can give you some information about how many air you put in, but not how many air will be dissolved in the medium in the process. So in that case, you need to go for the TIRs. So that was overall the presentation about the BERs and the TOS BERs. Today it was a quite short topic because it's a system that we already have on the market for many, many years. It is quite clear. So if you summarize it in those points, I think there are not so many questions open. If you have questions, please feel free to contact us at any time. If you need a layout for the machines and you feel insecure about that, please contact us or our official distributors, and then everything will be fine. So Christoph has raised his hands, so maybe Susumu can help me with the question. Yeah, that is true, but the competitors has most probably invested in the testing process as well. So this is something that we decided not to do. The testing according to the latest European standards is a quite important and a quite costly issue. So we decided not to do that for the BERs. And this is just simply the reason why we cannot provide kilogram or two oxygen inputs. If the competitors have invested in that and have put their efforts in the machines and the testing and the certificates, they can surely offer the figures. We would also be able to do that, sure, if we test the machine, but we decided not to do that for financial reasons, for example, or also for cost effort benefits, because I mean, the BER from our point of view is not one of the best sellers. And we also have a suitable system with the with the TINs. They are tested, we can offer them in those kind of applications, and we don't want to have a second system that is cannibalizing our TINs. Hope that answers the question. Any other questions, Sumo? No? Okay, then, Christoph again. So, we're waiting for the question. Okay. Yeah.
There's no question in the chat.
Okay, so there's no question in the chat. So Christoph, I would recommend if you got some questions, you got my direct email contact, just send the question to me and then I will surely answer, or we can have a short telephone conversation, will also be absolutely fine. So, thank you very much for everything. So if you got questions, call us. We will be able to support. We will be willing to support. In the meantime, stay safe. So Sumo is getting close. So we have to be safe as well. Stay safe in those crazy times and then see you in a couple of weeks with a little bit more voluminous topic again. This time it was a short one, but I think it will be fine. Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.